we're going to have a little rap session about the rapture here. 4 days away now from 12/21/12, and 8 days away from Christmas. And as usual, we'll go about this in our own unique way. So we'll start out with the day today, and planted a lot of flowers, put down a lot of bark, beautified everything. Everything's looking very sharp. Checked the weather forecast, and very bad weather all the way through January 10th. Just rain, cold, rain, cold, rain, cold. Just like, wow, total winter weather pattern. Nothing as far as weather to look forward to. But how about Christmas? How about 12/21/12? How about that? Now, due to the communication with that takes place here on this channel, it's a collective effort. I get a lot of help from the viewers, and we're all helping one another and sharing what we have. So the question about the rapture came up, and I haven't really been thinking about it, to tell you the truth. So I started thinking about it, and intuitively, suddenly something snapped together, and I said, whoa. Some pretty amazing quote-unquote coincidental stuff suddenly happened, and it set off alarm bells. I said, and a whole process of sort of putting it together clicked into place. I said, well, why not make a video of this, share it with everybody. Now, we had this crisis called Hurricane Sandy, and a lot of people are still deeply traumatized by it, and why not, really. It was quite something. And then we just had something at Sandy Hook. First Hurricane Sandy, and then Sandy Hook, the Hook of Sandy, as it were. Now, I haven't paid any attention to it. I continue unbroken my clarity that all of existence totally unnecessary. Starting from there, what's the root of suffering? I always try to stay at the root of suffering. So the remedy is very clear, very clear. However, various people have mentioned things, and I just sort of, a couple hours ago, an hour ago, heard the name Sandy Hook for the first time. I said, what? Sandy Hook? Are you kidding me? First Hurricane Sandy, and then Sandy Hook. Now this one, at an enormous trauma, and you'll recall my videos how I talk about the goddess of destructivity, as it were, is orchestrating this rollout of trauma, one trauma after the other. I saw what it's all about and how it's going to happen. So here's this another trauma right on the heels of the previous one, with a very similar name, and then a hook, something that hooks us, right? What's it hook us into? Well, that's a good question. Now, there have been those who talk about what's called Project Bluebeam, I believe. I'm familiar with the basic gist of this, is that there will be, using satellites and lasers, there will be a holographic projections in the atmosphere, in the air, in the sky, of deity figures, of figures that various people have worshipped throughout history, whether it be Krishna or Buddha, Jesus, Muhammad, Lao Tzu, various and sundry images that evoke the greatest emotion from people. And that this is somehow, it's not all clearly worked out what's going to happen, supposedly, but anyway, the idea is that lasers from different satellites in the sky will be able to triangulate and coordinate to produce these holographic images, and then somehow they'll be able to give us some auditory, like we're hearing something within us, and then we think that this is God or something talking to us or something like that. The purpose of exactly why they would do that is something that I'm, right at this very moment, I'm not completely clear about. But So some have talked about this Project Bluebeam, okay, as some kind of vast con on the world. A vast con. Severely bad thing to trick the people of the planet in some way. Now, it's interesting that we're coming up on this date, the end of the Mayan calendar date, which is for most people in the world know about it. And it's a time that is highly charged emotionally, but even more so, vastly more so, because of the various crises that have been taking place, especially the United States, East Coast United States, which, let's face it, as much as us West Coasters like to think how cool we are, the center of the United States is on the East Coast. And I'm just, you know, why argue with facts? It's the truth. And so the East Coast getting traumatized severely is really traumatizing the United States, and the United States is so important globally that the United States getting traumatized is a big deal. It's a big deal. It's happening now just before the end of the Mayan calendar. We expect the world to end. Some do. The end of the world is coming. Now, what if this Project Bluebeam or something like that took place on the 21st? Just right before Christmas and the holidays, where everybody is in this very raw state. Now, I want to bring something else into the equation that maybe we haven't put two and two together yet. And here on this channel, we feel free to speak our mind, even though some of the material might be a little bit rawness to it. But we need to do this now. There's been an unprecedented outpouring of prayer that God send his love into the world out from this situation at Sandy Hook. So the world is in a very prayerful state, which is often for many highly emotional, highly charged emotional, praying for God's love, praying for God to give us a sign that he loves us. Okay, are you following me? Now, what if these holograms were projected in the sky? What would the reaction be to those who have been fervently praying, saying that there's been a terrible, terrible evil in the world, and we're praying for God to give us a sign of his love and answer our prayers finally. And then here we have Jesus projected as a hologram in the atmosphere, saying we're speaking to us, somehow we're able to audibly hear it. They have the technology to do that, apparently. What would be the reaction of people, you see? And what would the follow-up be? I mean, obviously, people are in a state of mind right now where they could easily fall for such a thing, couldn't they? They most certainly could. Now, I had a dream recently where we were going down a runway in an airplane. I said, okay, we're getting ready to take off. And then at the last second, the plane didn't take off. And the pilot said, whoa, we have a problem with the engine. No takeoff. I said, wow, what's going on? They opened the engine up and they saw that there was this like cut in the line. One of the lines is like cut, fuel line or something. If we would have taken off, we would have crashed. And we said, wow, good thing the captain caught this before the plane took off. Otherwise, we would have crashed. I was kind of irritated, though. I said, wow, what a bummer. We didn't get to take off yet, but it's fixable. Let's fix it. Well, here we have an indication. And then I was watching a video that one of the viewers told me about the rapture. And someone saying that they felt they're being raptured up, but Jesus pulled them back down. And so someone commented saying, hey, that sounds like a false rapture. It sounds like, why would Jesus pull you back down if it were genuine? No, there's something bogus about going on. So there are indications, really, that something could be coming up. We know there's something coming up, but it could get very weird, actually. And we cannot be fooled by the weirdness. There could be a situation where there's some kind of false rapture or some fakery being used to turn the world in a certain direction, away from Christ, away from truth, away from deity, away from reality, in a very powerful way, thinking that, we are now interacting with God. God is appearing in the sky, or appearing somehow, and we're getting the answers, and then perhaps what we hear will be telling us that we need to follow certain leaders, we need to do certain things, and so people will take these directives as gospel, as truth, and follow them, because they're in this highly emotionalized state for many, many ways. Of course, we've been going through trauma after trauma in this world, and I think people are really fed up with it. I know they are. And they're desperate for some relief from these nonstop, terrible situations, some on a big scales like the tsunamis and earthquakes and devastating weather systems and weather events, and then human tragedy of just these, you know, senseless, crazy attacks, etc. People are so tired of it, and they're so desperate to get some relief from it. And they're praying for a sign, some relief, and then suddenly, boom, here is this manufactured situation where they will be extremely gullible and easily taken in by it. And they say, yes, this is it. Now we're getting the help. Finally, our prayers have been answered. For a long time, there have been people saying that this is planned, this is a planned event, that there's going to be a fake type of rapture or fake contact with deity or something like that. And many people, the world will be fooled, very badly fooled. So, as I was working on commenting on the video, a comment that I received, suddenly this bar popped up in my computer and says, you're getting a call from Skype. And I said, oh, okay. Then I clicked on it to answer the call. And then something clicked up and it says, your computer system is low, blah, blah. I suddenly realized it was a virus. It absolutely was a virus. And so I turned the computer off immediately. Then I safe started it. And I said, how in the world did I fall for that? I mean, it's unbelievable. Because I've had my computer and all my data lost before by clicking on a virus. I lost everything. All the work I had done for years and years and years, I lost everything just from clicking on that, Windows 07 virus or some kind of thing that was so cleverly done, and it was just awful. This one, no doubt, it was one of those very bad viruses that... So suddenly I was trying to comment on this very topic of the rapture, and suddenly I see this very bad, false, malicious thing pop up on my screen right at that instant. And I said, holy cow, there's something going on here. Let's take a look at this. And so it is not inconceivable that this Project Blue Beam situation actually could take place. Let us not say that it's inconceivable. It's not inconceivable. And let us not say that these horrible crises that we've been going through are not part of some pattern, some part of some kind of buildup. People snap because they've been directed to snap. They've been pressured to snap. People don't normally do horrific things unless they're like a Manchurian candidate type of situation, someone who has been built up and ready to be triggered to bring about these severe crises. So these things are intentional, and what is behind it is the question. Now, as far as hurricanes, Sandy, etc., I don't know. People say that there's weather, they're making weather, they're able to influence the weather in certain ways, which is certainly possible. At any rate, the timing of the situation is certainly interesting. It deserves comment. This whole thing deserves comment. And I'm just sort of fleshing it out here, bringing it up, and maybe some people will start making connections and say, hey, wait a minute here. me clicking on that Skype, it got me. It got me. Because I've never gotten a call on Skype before. I didn't know what it was like. And I just signed up for Skype recently, so I thought someone was trying to call me on Skype. So I said, oh, what do? You click answer. So, you see, And then looking back and saying, now you never click on anything that pops up on your screen like that. Never, 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 never. And yet I did, but I was quickly fortunately, my computer does not appear to be infected. I do have antivirus software on the computer, and the databases are up to date. But it could have been showing me that people in the world are gullible enough to fall for this type of Project Bluebeam type of situation. They're gullible enough to do it. And they'll be infected, as it were, by the virus of false belief, misdirection. And they will then become easily manipulable by subsequent holographic displays that tell them what they should be doing. And you have a whole, like a new world religion suddenly arising from this. You have a massive shift in consciousness in the wrong direction, towards stupidity. And the funny thing is, such a situation would be an attempt to misdirect people right before the genuine article takes place, you see. And then the false one would say, you don't need to do the rapture, God is now here, that type of thing. You see how that works? As people would say, oh, yeah, everything's going to be fine here. God is loves the planet, he loves everyone, and everything's going to be taken care of. We just have to follow the guidance that we're getting from these entities in the sky. And they say that there's no real rapture, or whatever. In other words, you can see the modus operandi of how it works, how it could work, where people would turn against their inner intuition, inner knowing, inner truth, because they've been emotionally hooked on these holographic entities or something along those lines, some kind of false truth, as opposed to what is truly true. It must be pretty amazing. It must be pretty slick production coming up. And we may even have some of the head honchos of the world, the movers and shakers and heads of state, etc., saying, yeah, this is legitimate. We bow to this, etc., etc. So none of this is inconceivable. The pattern of events that have been taking place just recently are kind of a very strong tip-off, could be interpreted that way, that something is going to dupe the world. Now, I said in another channel, Clarity Ross channel, I believe this, I had a video called This Will Be the Last Christmas. That was, I believe, back in 2011. I believe that was. I hope so. meaning that the Christmas of 2012 will not be celebrated in the way that we expect. That something's going to happen prior to Christmas. Now, I hope I'm wrong. I hope that just came to me intuitively. But there's a sense that is possible. Because people are in a state. Now, I told everyone several weeks ago, or maybe a week ago, but I said, stop watching the news, okay? I said that. That was my very strong advice. And I stopped watching the news several weeks ago. Entirely, not paying any attention anymore, and I felt it was super important. So what's the benefit of that? I feel very cool, very calm, very centered, very clear, very untroubled, uncluttered, able to focus, laser-like focus on truth. Okay, very strong focus on truth, on the root of suffering, all of that, and I don't feel pulled and fragmented in any way. Obviously, I sidestepped the trauma situation, the trauma event, I guess it was last Friday, and so it's not reverberating in me at all. It's not reverberating anyway, which enables me to look at the situation very clearly without any reverberation or emotionalism or anything. Just very calm, saying, okay, maybe let's take a look at this. Very objective, very calm, that type of thing. There's no emotional reverberation. My emotional body is very calm. That, you see what a great benefit that is. What a great benefit it is. Super important, your emotional body be very calm right now. And whatever you can do to truly calm it down. But not watching the news is super important, very important. And hopefully you weren't watching it and you've already been detached from it. If not, then you've dug yourself a little bit of a hole, actually. There are certain times when you need to stop viewing. I remember back, I don't know what year was it, that 19, was it 1999 or something? I remember I got this intuitive message coming through very strongly that I had to stop watching television. And I knew it was so strong, I realized this was coming from the quote, unquote, higher self, or grace of God, or Holy Spirit. I was very certain that. And I said, oh boy. I said, I've been watching it to vet it, you know, observing it and vetting it and saying what's going wrong. And this intuitive knowing said, yes, but that's true, but that's over now. You've done enough. It's time to stop. And I said, well, don't worry, I know how to avoid the bad stuff and I know how to handle it. And this knowing, intuitive knowing said, the fact is, if you continue to watch it, you won't reach your goal. You will not, you will come up short and fail to reach your goal. And it says, plain and simple, you choose, but I'm telling you, you will fail to reach your goal. So my advice is to stop watching, very important. And at that point, I suddenly decided, okay, all right, I'll go with this. And I stopped watching altogether. Cold turkey. I didn't watch a minute of television, I think, for at least a year, maybe 2 years. Not even a second. Nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing. And from that point on, I have rarely watched anything since. I watched like a few golf tournaments and some baseball games. And that's pretty much it. Maybe I'll catch a quarter or two of a 49ers game or something, but not very often. And so I really did stop, and that was instrumental in helping me. Super important. So in other words, what that intuitive knowing told me says, you got to stop right now, because it's going to get really weird. It's going to get really bad, and you won't be able to effectively vet it properly. You need to just withdraw, sidestep it. I said, okay, I did it. Again, just recently, I got this intuitive knowing, I have to stop watching the news, meaning online. I didn't watch the news on the television, but I looked at it online on the various, you know, news pages online here, like a Google News or something like that. And I was told, stop watching it online. Don't watch any news at all. Just detach from it. Don't be involved in that anymore. So I did it. I said, okay, and look what happened. Very important, sidestepping. So this intuitive knowing, when you get it, it tells you to sidestep. It tells you when to sidestep. And when you need to sidestep, you have to do it, or else it'll be too late. Or else you're going to be in trouble. So we're coming up on momentous times, actually. There's a lot of momentum in the world, but it's not good momentum. It is momentum towards being deceived. Tremendous amount of momentum towards being deceived. And then there's a few situations in the world that there's momentum towards sidestepping this deception. So make sure that you have momentum towards sidestepping the situation and you're not engaging. Sidestepping requires very savoir-faire, as it were, to sort of have this feeling like, I can just, you know, just easily just sidestep that. Confident, easy, not a problem, and just do it. And then you did it. It's no big deal. Okay, did it. Fine. Great. Glad that I did it. That kind of thing. It's not a big deal. You just do it. But you can't please both belief and truth. It's impossible. You cannot. If you try to be loyal to both, you'll be disloyal to both. If you try to please both, you'll be disloyal to both. Really, you'll just be in a state of confusion. And you certainly don't want to please belief. So pleasing truth. Truth doesn't tell you to please belief also. No way. Jesus said that the world will hate you for my sake. In other words, belief will hate you when you follow truth. Very true. Jesus said, I didn't come to save the world, I came to condemn it. Meaning, yeah, condemning belief, saying belief is completely unnecessary. All this is completely unnecessary. So truth's not asking you to please belief or to make nice with belief or anything like that. It's saying just gravitate towards truth and trust in truth and go that way. Go towards accepting reality as it is instead of struggling with a hypothetical in which we see ourselves as in the future as being vulnerable and being annihilated. And a funny thing is today, to shift gears a little bit here, to get into some deeper teachings here, we'll let the other percolate, the possible massive global deception coming up, possible very soon, it is very possible, but let it percolate. Now, as far as deeper teachings go, we can shift gears into that. Now, what belief tells us is that, several things, is that if we believe that annihilation is real, that acceptance that it really will happen, that acceptance is what saves us from it. That means that we survived it. If we just believe that it's real, that means we survived it. In other words, accept that a reality can and will be annihilated, and then somehow that will enable you to survive the annihilation. That's what belief teaches. Total nonsense. Just magical belief is all it is. It also, what I noticed, is that belief provides you with these crazy magical confusions. The more crazy and confusing they are, it tells us that this confusion, severe confusion and contradiction, etc., is profound. And that by accepting this confusion and contradiction, etc., you are accepting and bound before something that is truly sacred and profound. In other words, confusion equals profundity for belief. So I look at some of the stuff in the world of teaching, I say, that's completely crazy. That's like truth and lies all mixed up together in some crazy, contradictory soup. And belief is bowing to this and saying, it's a mystery. You must have faith. It's totally profound. So you can take like primitive peoples in the highlands of like New Guinea or whatever, and easily you can introduce something that is obviously confusion or weird stupidity, crazy, something just makes no sense whatsoever, but present it like, aha, here is something so profound you cannot even understand it. And the primitive peoples who were easily taken in by superstition and magic and all that kind of stuff, thinking that all this stuff is magical and has all this power over them, they can easily fall for thinking that their lack of comprehension is a sign that what they're what they're apprehending, what they're seeing, dealing with, is profound, is sacred somehow, when it's not. It's just a stupidity. Like the stupidity of saying those who are willing to accept annihilation of reality as real are the ones who are going to be, who will survive the annihilation. That is just like utter nonsense. And yet people believe there's some mysterious profundity to it. No, it's just nonsense. There's nothing profound about nonsense at all. Not at all. And yet we fall for that. And no disrespect to the Highlands people of New Guinea, because there's some that are quite wise there for sure. But they do have a tradition of, as many people do, of being caught up into fears of magic and superstition, etc., as we all have throughout history. This is something we're prone to. And that can tie in with the whole mass global deception, Project Blue Beam, whatever is coming up, situation, is that it'll be so confusing that people will be in an emotionalized condition, will fall for the oldest trick in the book, is thinking that this is something truly sacred and profound, just simply because they cannot understand what's happening. That is the worry. That is the problem, isn't it? That the world has been dumbed down over the last 50 years to an incredible extent. Incredible extent. And they've been emotionalized to an incredible extent through the mass media entertainment empires. And they're ripe for being deceived right now. And to think, attach some kind of sacred profundity through faith and mystery, in the great mystery and confusion and indecipherableness of what is taking place, as if it is somehow that means it must be coming from God, it must be profound, etc., etc. Now, that is not the way that God works, God's plan works at all. It's not the way that the ambassadors of servitude work at all. For an example, if Jesus were to come back in the world, he would certainly go to those who were not in awe of him at all, and who are very calm and relaxed, and would just say, okay, this is the teaching, and all of this is completely unnecessary. All of existence, totally unnecessary. And then those who can see that would just say, yeah, I see that. See it very clearly. And you say, great, that's good. And just be very calm, just hanging out. There's no big production. There's no bells and whistles, anything like that, no. Because what is being looked for is calm certitude. Is certitude based on clear seeing, not on any emotionalism, not on any mystery, not on any faith, not on any of this stuff, but actually being able to say, hey, I've looked within, and that's what, and I know what the root of suffering is. See? So that's the way that the great teachers, ambassadors of certitude work, is they find the devotees, the disciples who are very mature. So they're not going to get it all screwed, things all emotionalized and believe what they say just based on because they don't understand it, thinking it must be profound. No, they're saying, who understands this? Who's looked within? Who is prepared? Who is prepared? That's how they work. They're not into magic shows at all. Not at all. So when you see this razzle-dazzle production, you've got to say, who are you trying to fool? It's ridiculous. I've tried to introduce some of the great teachers of the past just so you can see how they function. Maybe I should do a video on that. I don't know. It could also be twisted in people's mind, but maybe I'll think about it, because the people here, if you're expecting, like, oh, here's a great teacher, and then you see them in the sky, you say, oh, there they are. You know, that is not how they work. It's not how they work. Very low-key, very humble, very unassuming. They'll just briefly mention something that they see that's helpful for you. Often very quiet, not saying anything. Just very happy and peaceful and calm. And they're just basically reassuring you, hey, this is all unnecessary. Everything in existence is totally unnecessary, which is why they're not being affected by it. They're not reacting to it in any way. They're saying you don't have to react to what you're seeing at all. Turn it all over to the Holy Spirit. You see, existence only lasted for a moment. We've already let go of it. We're just living on a memory of it, really. But we're hooked on this memory. And so what we do is we turn this over, this one moment we and the memory we have of it, turn it over to the Holy Spirit, to the grace of God, who knows how to handle it properly, who was created specifically to bless it. We don't know how to handle it. We can't handle it properly. But the Holy Spirit can. So by turning it over to the Holy Spirit, exchanging it, actually we give it to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit gives us back a blessing, a blessed version of it. By doing that, we're free. We're free of it. And that's all we need to do. That's all we need to do. Don't need to react to what's going on in any way. Positive, negative stuff, great stuff, negative stuff. None of it. None of it. So the teachers won't even ask you to react to them. They're not fishing or trying to hook your reactions to them. That's not what they're looking for. They're looking to assure you that making the exchange is the right thing to do. That's what they're looking for. They're not looking to be worshipped, idolized, anything like that. They'll just plainly tell you, hey. Not even tell you, they'll irradiate. They say, look, the bliss I'm in, and this is because I'm seeing the overlay, the blessing of all the universe, the overlay of the universe. And I'm not reacting to anything that's taking place in the universe. I'm simply enjoying abiding in the overlay, the self, abiding in that. and that's the way to go. So they're not looking for quote unquote followers of them. They're looking for real, those who are willing to make this exchange. That's what they're looking for. And they're just, all they're doing is reassuring you that's the way to go. That's all they're doing. So if you know this, of course you're not going to be bamboozled by the big display, the big con that maybe may be coming up. It wouldn't be a surprise, would it, if something like this did come up? It would not be a surprise, no. As Terence McKenna said, that the time wave and all this kind of stuff, that we're by 12:21:12, all right, we're hitting the zero point of shifting into ultimate weirdness, or just basically, what was it, quantum weirdness or something, right? I mean, that's what the seers have said, is once we hit this date of 12:21:12, the whole situation is going to shift into this simply an entirely different realm of weirdness, that weirdness that we have not even considered, as it were. And yet, here we are considering it ahead of time. So not everybody is going to be caught by this net, not going to be hooked by it. But we're likely to see the whole thing shift in again into quantum weirdness. And no surprise if it does. No surprise at all. What I've been trying to do in these videos is get everyone normalized towards how teaching really works, so they're not bamboozled by the razzle-dazzle of that could be applied to this world, the quantum weirdness. Now, I was told that I'm a mid-level teacher. I'm a spiritual teacher, mid-level, meaning I'm not the big cheese at all, obviously, obviously not. But I'm able to be in the presence of the big teachers, the ambassadors of certitude, and not be in awe. And then I can pass on to others how normal it is, how sane it is, how normal it is, how low-key it is, how just basic it is, how unthreatening it is. And then in these videos, give people a sense, viewers a sense of it. Kind of just a faint taste of it, so to speak. Broaching the same topics that would be broached there. I'm aware of the whole curriculum that is taught. There's a basic curriculum. The basics are always the basics. The root of suffering is the root of suffering. We're dealing with facts. And facts always are factual. So this should have been helpful. These videos have been helpful to for you to simply say, hey, you know what? I can do this. I can do this. I can listen to this. It's not a big deal. It's not a big shift from what's being said on these videos to actually sitting in satsang with a real heavyweight guru, a sadguru, a savior, an avatar, etc. It's not a big shift. It's not a big shift. You'll just find it. You'll say, "Oh, this feels pretty normal." This is. Of course, I feel like this is the big time, but again, it feels normal. It feels pretty normal. For example, my job takes me through dealing with a lot of mansions, big mansions, super, super places, you know. And at this time, like if I were to be presented like with some kind of incredible, what do you call it, palace, I guess they call it. I just walk in there and say, "Well, okay, yeah, nice high ceilings, nice lighting, those cool windows. I like the treatment of the walls there. Oh, it's all engraved, and there's all this texturing, and the marble is really, it's cool marble, and whatever, yeah, nice windows, great kitchen, I don't know. Okay, feels pretty normal." sit down and feel like, okay, this is used to this. This is nice. It's better than the others for sure. Maybe much better, but still, it's nothing, you know, outlandish or weird or anything like that. It'd be normal. So you can normalize yourself to very profound situations, so that you don't feel in awe of them whatsoever. You say, hey, yeah, this is like super profound, and yet here I am. Yeah, I can accept this. So, if I ask myself, you can ask yourself, what if there was some satsang going on with, you know, whatever teacher, whatever's your ultimate teacher, and your ultimate teacher showed up. Let's say your ultimate teacher showed up. And there they are, and they're holding a little talk, a satsang, an inquiry, a contemplation, whatever, and you go there, and you walk in and sit down, and there they are. How would that be? You ask yourself that question. I'd probably be a little nervous, a little jittery, a little amped up, a little on point, etc. Sure, yeah. But you'd be there, right? You'd be there. And you wouldn't run away, or you wouldn't start shrieking, or you wouldn't get all emotional or say, this is completely beyond me. I just don't understand what's going on here, but can I just give you a hug? Can I please give you a hug? I need a hug. And oh, my life is so terrible. You know, oh, gosh. No. You'd probably sit down and be quiet. I just sit down, okay, just be quiet then. Let me pay attention. Just like that, just pay attention. Quiet attention, just pay quiet attention. What's going on? What do I notice? What can I notice? What can I get? Just be very observant, very attentive. That's the way. You don't become all volatile and start acting out all sorts of stuff. You don't act out some kind of script that you believe you're supposed to act out in the presence of that. You act from the voice of the preparation, the voice of clarity, the clarity and reason that has prepared you, tells you just be calmly observant. Just be calmly observant. Don't act out some crazy script. Because a lot of people have, deep down, have these scripts. They feel, okay, when I'm face to face with the most highest teacher I can possibly conceive of or whatever, okay, what do I do? And they have a script. Okay, well, good. I don't know what their scripts are, but you know what I mean. What's best is, again, quiet, just quiet attentiveness. Just be quiet. Don't act out. Don't scream. Don't yell. Don't run out of the room screaming hallelujah. Go up and down the street screaming at everybody, hey, they're here. Oh, my God, they're here. Don't jump up and start singing songs or chanting or clapping or leaping around. Or I don't know, just quiet attention. Say, okay, yeah, well. Glad you're here now. Just quiet attention. What's going on? What is it that would you know? What is it that you'd like to convey? Maybe just reassurance. Just as quiet reassurance there. So, these videos have definitely been done for a purpose, intuitive purpose. That they're preparation to help you sidestep a situation that could arise in the world that is very deceptive and misleading. The world itself is very deceptive and misleading, and ultimately has to sidestep the world. And, of course, that is by exchanging the world, exchanging this hypothetical scenario to the Holy Spirit in exchange for a blessed version. In other words, how you see it in return for a blessed version. Both are illusions. Both are hypothetical. Well, let's make that clear. The blessed version is just as hypothetical as this, as existence. We're seeing it. Both. Jesus says they're both illusions. I said they're both hypotheticals. I prefer that terminology. And I'm secure enough in my own clarity. If I see terminology that I feel it works better for me, I'll use it. But it's the same. He says these are illusions, or hallucinations. And of course, it's imagination. It's a hypothetical. Both are hypothetical. Existence as we've been perceiving it, and the blessed version the Holy Spirit gives us, is also hypothetical. It actually will never take place in reality. Even the blessed version will never take place in reality. And so after we experience the blessed version, the final step is taken by God, which is not something we need to concern ourselves with here at all. There's nothing to it. We just feel completely accepting of reality as it is at that point. And we realize we don't even need this blessed version of the hypothetical anymore. But it's an intermediate step. The blessed version of the hypothetical scenario, of this totally unnecessary hypothetical scenario, is the intermediate step. The overlay, as I call it, the blessed version, the vision of Christ, as Jesus calls it, those things. Another thing, if some great teacher is using certain terminology and you're freaking out, don't freak out if you have some different terminology. If Jesus calls it illusions, I'll say, okay, he's talking about the hypothetical scenario or whatever. You don't be tripped up by terminology. So if Ramana says abide in the self or the higher self or whatever, okay, you know what that means. Abide in the overlay. Abide in the acceptance of reality as it is, the blessed version of existence. It's all pointing in the same direction, so don't worry about words, about if you don't have the lingo down or something. Your own lingo can be easily translatable, so to speak, back and forth. Yeah, it's not like I say, oh my gosh, I'm not saying things the way that Jesus is saying them. Oh my gosh, I must be totally wrong. I must be, I'm bad. I don't deserve anything. Oh, I got to learn to say it just the way he wants to be said. Nah, that's nonsense. That is nonsense. You use the words that resonate most clearly within you. And some don't even want to say the Holy Spirit. Yeah, that's fine. You use whatever words you want. The grace of God, some call it the this and this and that, or different terminologies. The voice of clarity, the voice of reason. I use the voice of clarity. I like that, the voice of clarity. Or the overlay. I call it the overlay, but it could be vision of Christ, the blessed version of existence. No reason to get flustered by that kind of stuff at all. I can't possibly see how any teacher would have any trouble with those things. Ananda, my ma. Everyone used different terminology for her, and she was just great at making wordplay and laughing and showing you that it's all the same. It's all the same. No problems. No problems about that kind of situation. And of course, when we bring up belief-based situations and supposed understandings, then of course there's confusion. We get kind of like, oh, we feel suddenly lost. We just realize that we wanted to be polite to belief. He said, okay, belief, here's your turn. And we have to gradually learn not to give belief its turn, because it doesn't deserve its turn. It's done nothing to deserve its turn. It's only advocating insanity. Why give insanity a turn? It's had its turn. It's had its way with us for how long? Eons and eons, right? It's had its turn. It turns over now. Can't serve both. And of course, belief is desperately lobbying for a compromise as it realizes its own position is about to be eroded and lost. It'll throw up all sorts of compromises and ask the teachers, well, how about this compromise? How about this compromise? And the teachers say, that's a compromise. Forget about, there's no compromise with truth. Facts are facts. The hypothetical is totally unnecessary. How could there be a compromise? You cannot have something that's totally unnecessary and also necessary. You cannot. There's no such thing as partially necessary. It's either necessary or it's not, as far as reality is concerned, okay? And that is the touchstone. Reality is the touchstone. We're not talking about some abstract, something completely abstract that is detached from reality. Reality is the touchstone, is the cornerstone. Everything has to be related to reality. Either something is necessary for reality or it's not. And this hypothetical scenario of how to survive annihilation is completely unnecessary for reality, totally. There's no way it can be both necessary and unnecessary. Impossible. So when belief says, well, it will be necessary, and you say, no, it'll never be, and belief says, let's compromise it. It's being crazy. It's being insane. And you cannot entertain insanity. There's no point to teaching then. If you're saying to the teacher, let's entertain insanity for a while, the teacher's going to decline and say, let's not do that. It's a waste of time. Not a judgment. It's just a waste of time. And the teacher's here to help us save time. So, my advice is to get used to the teachers, the great teachers. Just observe them. Observe them. That's all. You don't have to understand what they're saying necessarily. Just get in the practice of quietly observing them. That's what I've done. I used Anandamayi because there's videos and a lot of pictures about her. Unfortunately, with Jesus, we don't have the videos, we don't have the pictures, and we don't even have any of his... We have teachings that were written down at some point, etc., etc. But having videos and pictures of someone who's been here during your lifetime, then you can really look at that and get a very good sense of what's involved. Very, pretty good. And there's cultural differences, of course. But by and large, you can get a feel. You can look at pictures or video of Ramana Maharshi, for instance, or various teachers like Punja Ji, and whoever strikes your fancy. You feel this one is my, you know, number one or whatever, or two or three. You can have three if you want or however, but this one is really great. And just observe them, quietly observe them, and see how they comport themselves, comportment, deportment, whatever, how they handle their business. Check it out. And if you've been checking it out, then you're not going to be suckered so badly by some massive global deception. You might initially fall for it. That is possible. But then you'll quickly realize, oh, this isn't it. No. And then you'll detach from it in time. You'll detach from it. You won't get the virus. You won't lose everything. You won't have your computer completely infected and crashed by the virus. And so far, nothing has happened. So it's been stable so far. It's good. I feel like I'm going to hold off on any videos of the teachers like Ramana or Anandamayi Ma, etc. Pretty much so, really. Because there's one problem that could happen, that people watching those, they might become very emotional. Suddenly they might be struck like, oh my gosh, this really is a true ambassador of certitude and a great resonator of reassurance here. And might get very emotional about it at this time, whereas right now at this time actually we need to be very dispassionate. So when I ask, can I upload some pictures, I have all the pictures of Anandamayi Mother that are in the world basically, and all the videos too. I have everything, and I say, can I upload some pictures, and they always get back the answer, no, don't do that, not now, it's not appropriate. I said, wow, wonder why. Well, maybe we know now why. Is at this time we have to do everything possible to be very dispassionate and non-unemotional. Detached, dispassionate, calm, centered in clarity. And it's not a head thing. Clarity is not really a head thing or a heart thing. It's neither. It's kind of a holistic, it's a total thing. It's a factual thing, I would call it. I don't feel like I'm in my head. I don't feel like I'm in my heart. I feel that I'm dealing with facts, factual, which feels like a very stable. I feel like I'm in a very stable place, as it were. Very profound, very stable. But I don't identify it with the body or the head or the heart or chakras or anything like that. I don't have any identification with any of that whatsoever. None. Sort of just a silent, attentive consideration, observation, noticing, trying not to react or not follow any reactions that happen. but not paying attention to whether I'm reacting or not. Here's an example, like if you're jogging, I'll use my own example. I jog, and sometimes, and go along just fine. Go along just fine. Go along fine. I'm just in a rhythm. Everything's great. And then I started thinking, like, okay, can I make this a little better by my breathing? Let me see if I can sync my breathing up. And as soon as I started thinking about my breathing gets all messed up. All messed up. I said, doggone it. Why did I do that? Two breaths, and I start thinking, how have I been breathing? Is it like one quick breath and then many breaths out, or two, three steps? And before you know it, you're tired, your running's all messed up, and your breathing's all messed up. Oh gosh, it's better not to think about it at all. If you can, when you're jogging, don't think about your breathing. It'll automatically sync the right way. As soon as you start thinking about it, it starts getting messed up. So don't consciously try to pursue, okay, I'm not following that reaction, I'm not following that reaction, because then you'll be seeking out reactions. Just continue on with your clarification, and automatically you will, as reactions arise, you will just say, okay, I'm not going to go with that one, and then you continue on. It's like that. Just like jogging and paying attention to breath, don't pay attention to it. And as soon as you do, say, oh, no, and somehow, don't try to pay attention to anything, really. The best way to jog is you're not paying attention to your stride, your feet, your breathing, your arms, how you're running. What I do is I kind of just have an overall sense of the situation without anything in particular. There's no particulars, really, except that I'm going to make it back to where I started. That's the only particular I have in mind. I just keep that in mind, that I'm going to grind this out until I finish. That's the only thought I'm having the whole time. I'm going to finish this, and everything else is just completely secondary and not important. Finishing is all important. So that's the attitude I have in spiritual practice, spiritual path, is finishing is all important. That's the only thing really is important. And just keep on focusing on finishing, as it were. And then everything else, you'll stay in a very good rhythm, very good flow, automatically. So I'm doing the best I can just by being very dispassionate, really. And in watching these videos, you should get calmed down, dispassionate, as opposed to emotionalism. You can compare the difference of this sort of approach to the emotionalism of other approaches. Most people in the world are still, the emotional approach still hooks them. It still hooks them. Even though they think they're very intellectual, easily hooked by the emotionalist approach, very easily. They're intellectual up to a point, but intellectualism is just an overlay. It's the overlay of belief. It's belief's version of the overlay, and it easily crumbles into emotionalism. Of course, it emotionalism is first of all given some sort of exalted rationale, right? Like, oh, is there some deity in the sky talking to me? Of course, it's all right to be emotional now. Holy cow! Throw everything to the wind. Let's just absolutely should be shaking and trembling. So you may have the elites of the world suddenly be shaking and trembling and handling snakes and speaking in tongues and all this kind of stuff and shouting hallelujah and say, hey, you know, that may happen. That may really happen. And if that happens, you might feel, oh my gosh, in order to appear intelligent, I need to go along with them, because the intelligent people are freaking out this way, getting really weird. Project Bloombeam, anyone? Letting the airplane go by. Okay, so you see, the world may think that this is it, we can't miss our opportunity, okay? And so that's why they'll jump at it. Now that plane was going by very loud, I said, okay, let's just sit here calmly, let it pass. We know the truth. Facts don't disappear. They don't escape. They're not trying to escape or go anywhere. They're not trying to obscure themselves. The fact that I can see the facts, see that this is all hypothetical and a completely unnecessary hypothetical scenario, that's not trying to hide from me. I can wait. I can wait 10 seconds and it's still there. Just can see it just as easily now as 10 seconds ago. No big deal. So, if there was some kind of massive global deception, just wait it out. Just say, okay, I'm just going to wait this out for a little while. And I know that facts are still facts and this isn't a fact. And when this dies down a little bit, then I'll be able to very easily get back into clear consideration. And don't be worried about it. Don't be worried about it. Facts are so simple, how could you possibly forget? This is all a hypothetical scenario. Completely unnecessary. Fact one, fact two. Exchange it to the Holy Spirit to receive the blessed version back, which is also hypothetical, but it's shows that there is no annihilation. It's a hypothetical non-annihilation. See, reality never deals with the issue of annihilation at all. It doesn't deal with being annihilated. It doesn't deal with not being annihilated. No reason to. Whereas because we believe that we're going to be annihilated, God gave a blessing to this insane belief, and the Holy Spirit will now show us this version of not being annihilated, which I call the overlay, or choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator is another way I describe it. And that's also hypothetical, but that's, we realize, oh, there is no annihilation. That's great. Here, I'm looking at something, there's nothing's being annihilated. That's great. And then that's easily translatable back to just dropping the whole issue of annihilation altogether. Both the hypothetical of being annihilated and the hypothetical of not being annihilated, you let them now. No issue of annihilation one way or the other at all. And then you're back fully cognizant of reality, functioning perfectly. And of course you realize you never left. That's the ultimate realization, is the realization you never left. Nothing ever happened. Nothing ever. When you can finally accept that nothing ever happened at all, then you're home. Nothing ever really happened. The blessing function of the Holy Spirit will remain to even augment reality. It doesn't change it. It doesn't change reality. It's a further expansion, extension of reality. So, when global deception should occur, if it should occur, I'm not prophesying that it will occur. I've seen enough to indicate that it could occur. It is possible that it could occur. You merely have to maintain your patience and your calm, dispassion, and saying, hey, this isn't my big opportunity at all. This isn't it. This isn't it. My big opportunity is to exchange, surrender all of existence, give it to the Holy Spirit, and in exchange receive the blessed version back. And you can do that at any moment, always. This moment, the next moment, each moment, you can do that right now, any moment. And you always, that will always be the fact. So, not react, jumping into this situation, that's not going to threaten you at all. It's not going to threaten your sanity at all. Don't be stampeded like lemmings into some situation. Oh my gosh, this is it, I gotta go or whatever, I gotta get with this immediately. No. Especially because you're doubtful of it, right? Let it sit. A teacher, a real teacher, a true teacher will sit, will just sit and wait and until you're ready. And when you're ready, then okay, that's reassurance. And if you're not, they're not worried about that they're going to lose their clarity. Not at all. Facts don't blink on and off. They don't hide. They don't get lost. They're completely obvious, completely open, always. It's always the case. So don't be panicked, don't be alarmed, don't think that you gotta jump at something. If it doesn't feel jumpable, you don't feel like he's jumping. Truth is always true. Completely teaching, true teaching is completely simple. Completely simple. Completely basic. The root of suffering is very simple and basic. We had the desire, we wanted to be prime creator, so we had the desire to experience this, which gave rise to the desire to change reality. And any change in reality would actually be the annihilation of reality, so it gave rise to the strategy of how to survive the annihilation of reality, which is completely hypothetical scenario in a hypothetical place we call time or the future. And it's all totally unnecessary because reality will never be annihilated. Can never. Why? Because it can never be changed in any way. And so this is all a contingency plan that we're working on that will never be needed. There you go. One paragraph, you have the teaching, and then simply exchange this contingency plan, give it to the grace of God, and the grace of God will return it to you in a blessed version, which is a version of no annihilation. The overlay, the choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator results in this blessing, this overlay of every no annihilation is present. And you're not reacting to any annihilation. You don't, it's a blessed version of it. And then you're saved. And then the final step, which we don't need to deal with, we're taken by God, which basically realize nothing ever happened. No need for even the blessed version of non-annihilation. Because again, everything that's happening in this world, death, etc., it's only hypothetical. So you can just as easily hypothetically see it's not taking place. So you see people die, everything dying in this world, you can just as easily see a world where nothing's dying. That's also hypothetical. And yet that's easily translatable back into reality, where nothing can be threatened in any way. The very notion of threat is never even comes up. But because we're familiar with the hypothetical, it's helpful to have a sense of continuity to have a blessed version of it, hypothetical, that which then intermediate step. So we can easily see, just as easily see, a world where absolutely nothing is dying at all. Nothing's being threatened, nothing's being harmed. Everything's completely blessed. Just as easy as seeing this hypothetical, just a hypothetical. This world of death, suffering, impermanence is totally hypothetical. We can also see a hypothetical universe where everything's permanent. Nothing is being threatened, nothing's dying, nothing's changing, everything's completely blessed. We can also see that. Or we can see in some version, in some way, hypothetical, where it all, we don't see any annihilation, a hypothetical version of non-annihilation. We can see that. We can just as easily as we're seeing, perceiving this one. Not a problem. Holy Spirit, easy. Just a hypothetical. And actually, the Holy Spirit is an aspect of Spirit. And it's Spirit that made this hypothetical. That mind in the service of Spirit has imagined this hypothetical. So, Spirit can also entertain another hypothetical, except this time hypothetical of non-annihilation. Very simple. So if Jesus were here, and he told me to explain this, I'd explain it just like this, and he would probably say, that's pretty much it. Yeah. Pretty much it. You got it. That's what I expect. I say, yeah, this is it. This is what you taught. This is what I've been learning. This is what I've been paying attention to. This is pretty much it. I mean, I'm in the ballpark for sure. But if there's some adjustments need to be made, okay, fine. Make some adjustments. No problem. So, what we have to look forward to, I call the big boost, is simply the availability of some of these really perfect teachers, radiators of reassurance, resonators of reassurance, radiators of reassurance, avatars of acceptance, and great, great ambassadors of certitude. Having access to them in some way would certainly be very helpful for us, and not at all frightening or awesome or anything like that, really. Because we can just say, hey, is it kind of like this? And they say, well, you need to make, you know, this kind of, sort of like that, make a little adjustment. They're just here just to remind us of the truth, just tell us of the truth and assure us that this is it, and this is fine, and you can do it, just like that. Will there be some other aspect to it? I don't know. But the basics will certainly be there. The facts will certainly be there. Have to be there. Facts will be there. So rest on facts. Rest on facts. Rest on getting normalized with facts. Don't go over some mysterious profundity that is so mysteriously profound that you need to have complete blind faith to even go for it at all. And then being told that having this completely blind faith and willing to accept this on total blind faith with, because it's so confusing that you it's such a mystery, you have no way of being able to ascertain at all what the factual nature of it is at all. Don't go with that. Don't go with that. Facts aren't like that at all. There's not some profound mystery at the heart of it at all. Just facts are at the heart of it. Reality is what it is. That's a fact. It's not a profound mystery that it is what it is. Maybe from the standpoint of the hypothetical of annihilation, it's a profound mystery, but not to reality. And we are children of reality. We don't have to deal in from the standpoint of belief, which is the guidance of the hypothetical. We don't have to deal with it from the standpoint of belief. Of course. So, what belief will do is give us some absolute nonsense and then call that profundity and tell us to submit to that nonsense. We don't have to submit to nonsense. When we know what facts are, we don't need to submit to nonsense at all. That's very simple. It's not all complex and esoteric and mysterious and beyond our comprehension and all this nonsense. Not at all, not at all, not at all. It's beyond the comprehension of belief. See, the belief believes it's God. And therefore, we should pay attention to belief and follow what it says, etc., etc. And most of the people of the world throughout history have followed belief as if it were God. It's not God, not God at all. I always say that God is God. You know, people show up in this world and they say they're Jesus. Well, I always say, well, Jesus is Jesus. If someone asks you, are you Jesus? Jesus is Jesus. Why does anyone need to say they're Jesus? You have access to the same facts Jesus does. Reality is just completely factual. It is what it is. Why does somebody need to say that they're Jesus when they're not? Why? They have access to the same facts. They have access to the same blessed hypothetical of non-annihilation. Exactly the same access to it. Same access. Nobody needs to say that they're Jesus if they're not. No, if Jesus comes back and is the real Jesus, well, fine. And he says, Jesus is Jesus. Okay, that's fine. And we will know him by his teachings for sure, and by the reassurance, and it would be unmistakable, as any great teacher, any perfect teacher would be. But why did anyone need to say they're Jesus when they're not? Again, they don't need to do that. Because they have access to the exact same facts, exact same blessed hypothetical scenario as anyone else, as Jesus did, as anyone else. They're a child of reality. They never left reality, just like Jesus never ever actually left reality. Neither did any of us. No one ever left reality. No one, not even one aspect of spirit ever left reality whatsoever. It's completely impossible. There's nowhere else to go. Entertaining a hypothetical and imagination is not leaving reality. So no one has ever left reality. So just be who you are. Because you never left reality either. Nobody did. Nothing ever happened. Nobody ever left reality. I just felt like intuitively I should say, well, for the purpose of giving these videos out, I'll say Clarity Ross, meaning that kind of denotes that there's some teaching going on here, some sharing that is on the level of clarity, inner clarity. So I said, okay, why not? That's okay. That's all right. But when you get in contact with facts and you accept the blessing, the overlay, you don't have to say, oh, I must be Jesus or something. No. You are the same. We're all one. We're all part of the sonship. We're all Christ. We're all part of the sonship. We're all one. We never, none of us ever left reality. So you don't. You just say, okay, I'm. You can use your own name if you want to. Sometimes people have some spiritual experience. They change their name. A lot of people use Indian names. You know, change their name. But if you want to, okay. If you don't want to, it's the same. The facts are the same for everybody. Changing your name doesn't change facts. And you can use just a plain old name. Because, again, the plain old name, you never left reality either. You never left reality either. So who's greater or who's lesser? Nobody's greater and nobody's lesser. Nobody ever left reality. Not even Lucifer left reality. No. Lucifer may have been the first who said, wait a minute, what if there's some annihilation? Oh, I want to be prime creator. Then, oh my gosh, there's the reality is going to be annihilated. I need to get this hypothetical scenario and survive reality. And then others said, well, what's going on there with Lucifer? You know, it might be good to have this contingency plan, maybe, et cetera, et cetera. That's how the myth goes, et cetera. But Lucifer never left reality either. No, it's impossible. Where is there to go? How can you leave reality? Reality is all there is. How can anyone leave reality? It's impossible. And reality can't be harmed or threatened in any way, so how can anyone cause damage to reality or threaten reality? Cannot. It cannot. So nothing's ever happened. It's only been a hypothetical. So again, no one's greater, no one's lesser, and there's no need for judgment. No one needs to judge one another. Judge not lest ye be judged. And that's meaning totality. If you judge someone, you're meaning what Jesus says about judgment means, what he means is, if you judge somebody, what he's talking about judgment, is you're judging them as having left reality. That's their judgment upon them. If you make that judgment, that means that it's possible to leave reality, and you're judging then yourself. But you must have left it too. If it's possible for one, it's possible for all. And you're condemning yourself to having left reality, as it were. And you might think, oh, well, I haven't, but they have. But again, reality is all one. So if they left, you left too. The sonship is one. It can't be fragmented. It can't be fragmented. So if you, Jesus said, judge not lest you be judged, meaning don't accept for a moment the belief that anyone has ever left reality or ever could. Otherwise, you will believe that you have left reality. And then you will be caught up in this, desperately trying to figure out a way to survive annihilation. And you'll get caught up with this nonsense of trying to believe that annihilation is real, and believing that it's real will enable you to survive it. And then you're really lost in darkness. And you're really going to make sacrificial idols. Judge not lest ye be judged. Very simple. If you judge someone, that means you're really accepting that they have left reality. And again, sonship is one, means that would mean you have left it too. And then you're caught up in the hypothetical. Instead, don't make any judgment. Make the final judgment in that there's no judgment needed, meaning it's impossible to leave reality. No aspect of spirit has ever left reality. And then you realize, well, you couldn't have left either then. So you haven't left either. See, free your brother first, and then you realize you are free too. That's the teaching of A Course in Miracles. Is Jesus says, first see it in others, that they couldn't have possibly left. In other words, forgive others. Don't judge others. Forgive them, meaning they've never left either. Don't judge. Forgive this means don't judge them. Okay, let's cut to the chase even more. Don't pass judgment on your brother at all. In the sense, of course, they can act crazy, which is, you don't want to be acting crazy, but in the sense that they have left reality. They're apart from reality somehow. Don't make that judgment, because then you will feel that you too have, you've condemned yourself to death, as it were, of struggling to overcome annihilation, which means you keep suffering these traumas and deaths, etc., etc. And ultimately you're saying that if you left reality, it means reality can be annihilated, which means you can be annihilated. So you're ultimately condemning yourself to annihilation, as it were, hypothetically. So you don't want to do that. You want to free your brother from this crazy notion that they could leave reality. and then you'll realize that you cannot leave it either. That's how Jesus teaches in the Course in Miracles. Now I don't quite understand. I understand it, but I'm not quite up to speed on exactly why he taught the way he did. But it's okay by me. But he says, somehow he says that's the sequence that needs to take place. That first you have to free everybody else, and then you realize that you too, if it's impossible for them, it has to be impossible for you. There's some kind of generalization that automatically takes place. But again, he has many angles, gives many angles of ways to approach this. But certainly, he says judgment is very important, to drop judgment, make the final judgment, that no judgment is necessary because no one's ever left. So you can entertain the highest teachings like this. These are really the highest teachings. They don't get any higher. And you can entertain those. Not a problem. I'm not having any problem whatsoever entertaining them. And if there's something I'm not quite clear on, I say, okay, I'm not quite clear on that, but I'm close to it, so it's no big deal. And it's not a problem. Nothing happens as far as everything's going on just as it is. not a problem. So if you can entertain the highest kind of teachings, where you're dealing with direct facts, then certainly you don't have to be concerned about seeing any teacher whatsoever, highest teacher possible, because they'll simply be dealing with facts very clearly and adamantly, and they don't get off track at all. They're entirely available to share these facts at every single moment. Now, I'm not there. I'm not at that point yet. I'm just a mid-level teacher. I'm not constantly perfectly available to share facts flawlessly. No, I can sit down, focus on facts, and share them. But the highest teachers are constantly perfectly available to share and reassure nonstop. Even when they're not talking, they're giving you perfect reassurance because they're abiding in facts. They're still the same facts we're talking about right here. The same facts. Not any different. Not any different whatsoever. They may express them in different ways. It may sound more beautiful, more poetic, and more profound, etc. So it's still the same facts. Exactly the same facts. They might use different terminology, etc. But they'll still be talking about the same facts. That nobody can ever leave reality. Nothing's ever happened. This is all hypothetical. It's all imagination. It's all, and you can receive the blessed version of it back, and a version of non-annihilation. Don't judge, lest you be judged. Because they're just basic facts. Basic facts is all it is. It's all it is. So, if you can handle this, you can handle the highest teachings. You can, are the highest teachers. You can handle it. Absolutely. You don't need to come all unglued, like, oh, they're going to tell me something completely different. So, I'm over my head now. Oh, I'm drowning. Whoa, and then getting all panicky, and then, give me a hug, please. Give me a hug. I need a hug. Yeah, you can get a hug, I guess, but you don't need to do that. They're not dealing with different facts. Same facts. So you sit down, okay, and you're going to get a more clear version of the same facts is what you'll get. And super reassurance that these facts are true. You get super reassurance and just like, wow. You get a sense like, wow, this really is easy. That's a get. Wow, it's not as difficult as I thought. Wow, truth really is true. You get that, wow, truth really is true. Yeah, and I can accept that, yeah. It's not so difficult. It's easy. Yeah. Wow. I can really do it. Yeah. It's just like, hey, I'm right here. I'm right here. That's good. I'm right with it. And you just get that sense. And it's sort of like some elation, sort of like, oh my gosh, yeah, I'm really close. And just be calm about it. And so this is all preparation for the big boost. The real big boost. Don't get hooked by the fake big boost. All right, don't get hooked by it. And if you get hooked by it, spit the hook out quickly, quickly. You say, oh, I remember, yeah, okay, this isn't it, gosh. Just like I clicked on that stupid virus there, I can't believe I clicked on it, you know, that's amazing, gosh. Because I'm so careful, I really am very, very knowledgeable about viruses and not getting trapped by all these phishing scams and all this stuff. I mean, I'm normally the one that people come to and say, hey, is this a scam? And I look it up and I say, yeah, it is. I'm telling everybody else all these scams. So here I am, and I clicked on this Skype thing. It's like, wow. So, hey, if you get momentarily hooked into this situation, okay, just drop it real quickly and say, wow, everything okay? Yeah, it's okay. It's like, huh. That's pretty tricky. It's pretty tricky. Gotta give those people credit. How in the world did they know that I had just downloaded Skype and want to use it? That's the thing that hooked me. I wanted to use it. I wanted to start calling people on Skype. And suddenly, the menu bar calls up. Someone is calling you on Skype and answer. I said, wow, here's a perfect opportunity to start my first Skype session. Turns out to be a virus, you see. So there's a trick to it. So what happens is these holograms could arise and everyone in the world will say, how did God know that we were praying so desperately for help right at this moment? And here's suddenly the answer. And the people say, oh, this must be legit. This must be legit. The timing of it, you see. And that's what hooked me, is that I wanted to use it. I wanted to use Skype. And I said, here's my opportunity. Why don't I just jump in? Because I've been procrastinating. I felt, why don't I just jump in right now? Got hooked by it. But fortunately, I didn't make the advice that was given me of saying, in order to continue, you need to disable your antivirus software, and because your system is running low and can't run this properly, this call cannot come through until you disable your antivirus. It was saying to do that, and I said, you know, wow, this is a virus for sure. So, you may be hooked initially on what's happening in the world. You emotionally, okay, your emotions may be hooked. But something inside of you is going to see your voice of clarity say, oh, wait a minute, this is a virus, this is a scam. Let's drop the hook. And all we need to do is keep dealing in facts, And even the greatest teachers of all simply deal in facts, easy facts for you to understand. They just reassure you that the facts are true. Truth is true, that's all. The reassurance is profound. The facts are simple and basic. So get that, remember that when you're hooked. Emotionally, you get hooked and say, oh, I really want a response. And finally, my prayers, I've been praying my whole life and no response. And suddenly, here's the response. And because the whole planet's been praying because of this trick strategy. And finally, God listened. And that's what I want. I got to go with this. And realize that's an emotional thing. God has always been within you, nearer than near, just waiting for you to accept the overlay, the hypothetical of non-annihilation. And it's still waiting for you. Still waiting. You'll wait as long as it takes, patiently. Calmly, blissfully, no problem, waiting for you to accept that, make the exchange, accept the blessed hypothetical of non-annihilation, the overlay, and just waiting for that. That's what God's waiting for, and preparing you for that. That's truth. Those are facts. All this other stuff, mumbo jumbo, all this kind of stuff, this glamorous emotionalism, and et cetera, et cetera. Don't fall for it. Of course, your emotions can get hooked. Of course. I say even mine can get hooked too. Yeah. So, but I'm aware of it. It's possible to get hooked by it. So just be possible you might get hooked by it and the emotions will get hooked and you need to disengage, unhook the emotions from it. And I'll be here to help you for sure. And you know I can do that. Not a problem. Maybe I'll have some friends help me out. I don't know. That is to be determined. possibly. I'm not in awe of anybody, not in awe of anyone. Because again, we're all dealing with the same facts. Nobody ever left reality. I didn't leave, you didn't leave, nobody left. So what is there to be in awe of? The sonship should not be in awe of itself, okay? We're all part of the sonship. We're all one, the sonship of spirit. We should not be in awe of each other, should not. In awe of God, the prime creator, yes. Yes, in a certain way, yes. Beyond awe, just a total bliss and we can't even talk about it, but we should not be in awe of one another at all. Not disrespectful,
if there's something that's profound, then we can feel profundity. Someone's sharing profundity, that's fine. But not in awe. We should never be in awe of one another. Never. So I'm not in awe of any part of the sonship. Definitely not. And I've met some of the heavyweights, really. Really have met. I've met in spirit. I met Ramana Maharshi, came to me in living spirit, as being. And I met him and I had a talk with him and interchange, and it's pretty incredible. I just say the nicest guy I've ever met. Yeah, just the most beautiful spirit I've ever met. It's just, wow. Just left me with this feeling of like, my gosh, what a blessed soul that is. What a blessed soul that is. Truly blessed. Just, but I wasn't in awe. I was not in awe. Same with Ananda Mahima, same with Jesus. I've met all three of them, and I'm not in awe of them. At times it's like amazed, like, whoa, this is amazing or something. At this point right now, I'm not in awe. They gave me opportunity to work through that, work through this issue. We should not be in awe because we're all dealing with the same facts, and no one ever left reality, nobody. So whatever feeling like, oh, it's temporary, it's temporary, it's not necessary, it's something we need to go beyond. Gotta have to go beyond that. Belief will tell us, oh, you need to go into awe, you need to go into awe. This is some profound mystery, you can never understand it. You're in the presence of God because this is totally not understandable. Not true, because the facts are not understandable to believe at all. So it'll throw up, say, telling you you should go into awe. No, don't go into awe. Don't go into awe, no matter what. Just don't go into it. If you're fighting against it, don't get all negative and hateful. No, that's not it either. You shouldn't get that way either. You should not hate part of the sonship either. And if there's part of the sonship that's accept the blessing of non-annihilation, then they're very helpful. They're super helpful. Super helpful. So the attitude to wonder is super helpful is, of course, you facilitate the super helpfulness. You get with the flow of that. But you don't go into awe. That blocks it. That blocks it. And belief goes into awe. It tells the emotions to follow along. You say, no, emotions, don't. You're not listening to belief. You're listening to the voice of clarity and not belief. So you won't get hooked into awe and all that kind of stuff. So hang in there. Stick with it. We could be coming up upon a very weird time, but I'll be here in some way and certainly be able to calm everybody down. Whoever wants to be calmed down, centering in truth and facts, reassuring. And again, maybe I'll have some friends at that point. I don't know. Don't really know. If I do, I do. If I don't, I don't. Facts are still facts. And the fact is, none of us ever left reality. None of us. Not even one. So that should calm you down right there, shouldn't it? Absolutely. All right. Whew. Starting to get a little cold. Supposed to get really cold tomorrow night. Really cold. But hey, this is fine. I bundled up properly. So blessings to everybody. And we'll keep on keeping on. Stay centered, stay calm. You can handle facts. We all can. All right, very great, that's it.